Our next topic, rune boxes in events or while we playing the game normally, we find rune boxes anyway. But people don't know which one rune box is making money and which ones don't make money. People really don't know this. Now I will tell you the most valuable rune boxes and where you can find them. And let's start with the most worthless rune boxes, okay? Even these low value rune boxes, I have some tricks for you guys. Like, for example, apple robbing cauldron rune box. That rune box around like 100k gold, but you can get fragments like during the witches festival, which is ridiculously lowest price during the festival.
Collect that fragments cheaply during the festival, witches festival, and hold it on your bag or bank. Stack together these rune boxes, and when you sell these rune boxes about a month or 2 months after the festival over, you will get good money from there. Another remark: big earth ginger kitten rune box. Bigger ginger kitten rune box. You can find this seven rune box fragments in Karnvasten public dungeon in Somerset, and find these fragments and combine them. You can buy all these seven fragments as well. Their price around like 8k to 13k, 8k to 13k. Bar Guarstomp personality rune box. Guarstomp personality. You can collect all seven rune box fragments from Elsewhere prologue quests, but rune box fragments around like 3 or 2k, which is cheap. But finished rune box around like 50k. It cost you around 15k gold, like 35k profit.
Another rune box, Sijik Glove emote. You can farm and find 7 rune box fragments in Sunhold and combine. It's pretty simple, but you can buy these rune box fragments around like 2k to 4k, around like these prices. But finished Sijik Glove rune box price 200,000k, man. Which is 100k minimum earnings with zero effort, you know. It seems too interesting, right? Because not much people didn't want to deal with it. That's why full rune box price are like this. Oh, now let's talk about expensive rune boxes. Reach Mage Ceremonial Skull Cap rune box. That ugly thing have price around like 1 million gold made. How can you get this rune box? Combine 20 arena gladiators proof with a reach mage ferocity. You can buy from ferocity at war researchers in Cyrodiil. Like I said before, don't sell your gladiators proof to merchants, okay? Please don't sell at this item to merchants.
Siege Master rune box, another rune box. These rune box have two type, okay? One type completely uniform, total uniform, and second type is only helmet, close helm. Helmet price around like the 250k gold, but uniform the price around like 1 million gold. Runeboxes is obtained by using Siege of Cyrodiil, which consumes 15 Siege of Cyrodiil merits. You can get merits. You can get this merits in each of 1,000 Talwar you can find from Imperial City. And the Siege of Cyrodiil merits are, you can find from like Imperial City daily quests as well. You can find from quests as well. Oh, sixth house rope. That rune box have priced like 17k. But you can also get these runebox fragments, seven fragments, each one around like 5k. Swamp jelly pet runebox. Yep, swamp jelly runebox price around 60k gold, but fragments around like 2k. This rune box have 7-piece fragments. It mean minimum 15k profit. Elin here arena lion rune box. It's look really sick, by the way. This rune box price around like 2 million. You can get this rune box combine 40 arena gladiators proof. And available by completing conquest mission in Cyrodiil. Like I said before, don't sell your gladiator's proofs to merchant. Please don't sell it. When you find 40 arena gladiator's proof, 40 proof, it's mean 2 million, man. Don't sell this item to your merchants.
Another rune box, Timber Crow Wanderer costume rune box. It's priced around like 1 million gold. It cost you 50 Siege of Cyrodiil merits.
I'm gonna say this again. Please don't sell your trophies, merits, gladiator proofs. Don't sell this item to your merchants, please. Like, if you get minimum 50 merits, it's been one million, man. But you guys selling this proofs to merchants, don't sell, please. Don't sell to this merits proofs. Don't sell to your merchants, please.
Let's talk about Telvanni paintings. Velothi Triptych paintings. These paintings have three different type. First type, waterfall type. You can find this waterfall type at Furnishing Crown Store when you open your Crown Store in your house. And this Crown Star Furnishing Bound cannot selling at good stores. But we have two another type of painting, which is we can sell. These types are geyser and the volcano paintings. You can find that geyser painting price around like 5 million gold, and volcano type triptych painting price around like have 2 million gold. These two paintings, geyser and volcano, can be found at stealing from rune boxes in Wardenfell, but it is very very rare, not common. Maybe you found it before these two items, and even you sold it to merchant because you are not paying attention much. Since we started talking about rare items, let me expand the subject a little more. I wanna talk about soul shrimp skin. This skin still worth the farm. You can farm this skin in Molag Balbos, in Imperials the Severs. Price around like 1.5 million gold. But no matter how much they increase the drop change, it's very still low. Mostly you'll get from their Stonefire Scamp. The Stonefire Scamp have the price of Stonefire Scamp around like 15k.
Hollow Jack. Okay, Hollow Jack Spectre masks. That rune box you can farm this max from Plunder Skulls. You can get this Plunder Skulls from the boss mobs during the Witches Festival. The price was 50 or 60k or something like that during the festival, but now current price around like 500k. It's mean in other words, if you collect it while festival, during the Witches Festival, after you sell it 2 or 3 months later, you will double your money. Another emote Runebox, Rage of the Rich emote Runebox. Not much people trading these items, and not much people buying that emote Runebox, but that Runebox, you can get this Runebox with 30 Siege of Cyredul merits. I wanna talk about this Xivkyn Polymorphs. Imperial Steel Xivkyn Polymorphs. Xivkyn Polymorphs, this Runebox, Xivkyn Augur, Tormentor, Dreadguard. This Runebox, don't even try to buy this Runebox. Don't use your teller on that rune boxes and try to be selling that rune boxes. Don't get me wrong, but if you did that, that's the dumbest move in this game. You can find this 3 Xivkyn Polymorphs in Super B Imperial Reward coffers, which is really really cheap. I think I told you a lot of things that you can take an advantage of, and I hope you understand me. Now, another topic I really want to talk about, that furniture plants farm, because some of the things I see on YouTube made me really angry. So how you can farm this furnishing plants? You should
take, first of all, you should take your legendary man skill lines. Take all these legendary man skill lines. This fortune favor, cut versus art, and homemaker CP. Homemaker champion point, homemaker CP, most important CP for farming furnishing, because the homemaker CP increase your luck. You should search cabinets, cupboards, wardrobes, backpacks, desks, urns. Pretty much look under every stone like a goblin. Of course, I will share some place. I'm gonna share some places you should farm with you. I'm sure other people have told you you can farm furniture plants in here. Farming this map, farming this map, two map, this map. You can Google it. Where can I farm furniture plants? And you see tons of information about it. But I'm about to show you some specific farming locations.
For the talking about the locations, I'm going to talk about cooldowns. First of all, if some people say, oh, there is the recipe find cooldowns in game, they are bullshitting you. There is no cooldown for recipes and furnishing plans in the game. But only have purple recipe furnishing plans and style page. These three things have cooldowns in game. When you find the purple furnishing recipe, you are not going to find another purple furnishing recipe like minimum like 1 and 2 hour. You can find, but drop chance very low after you find first purple recipe. Game developers have not yet answered this question. Of there is a cooldown in game to find a recipe. We are sure about that. There is a cooldown for only purple recipes. But blue or green recipe or furnishing plans, you can find it instantly. When you find, and you can find immediately another. I think they brought the cooldown and not telling the people so that the price do not break and people do not collect too much. That's why I think they developers came bring the cooldown to the game. I remember when the Wardenfell map came as DLC like 2 or 3 years ago. Maybe I'm wrong for these numbers, but when the Wardenfell map came to game, I remember I find the tomb of urn, tons of urn and in one tomb, and I'm farming there all day long, and I made millions gold about with doing this. That's why I think they bring the cooldown to the game.
I understand that, but I'm gonna show you something. You can
some tricks you can use for the cooldown. This cooldown is character oriented, not account oriented, as far as I understand. You can find a 5 purple recipe in one hour with your only one character. This cooldown thing doesn't affect you if you have enough characters, like minimum 5 or 6 characters. Bring all your characters to the place where I'm gonna show you next, where you will farm furnishing plants. You need to bring all your characters, and this cooldown is ineffective if you farm all these characters there for a minimum of 20 minutes. It takes more than an hour in total. If you don't want to do this way, if you don't want, you can farm different maps with different characters. I mean, you can bring the one of your characters to Wardenfell at Tom's, and one of your character in the Artyom dungeon, and when you finish the one of them farming, you can log out and log into another one. This is it's gonna work well again. If we have to summarize, you will farm urns, cupboards on different maps with multiple characters, or take all your characters to one area and farm that area with your character and move on to second character. This is how it's work.
So where you can farm this furnishing recipes or recipes, I'm going to show you which maps you are going to farm. I'm going to show you fast as I can. I don't want to waste your precious time.
In this game, it's always better to farm furnishing plants on new released DLC maps. It's better to farm.
You can farm furnishing plants in Blackwood DLC. Steez like Gideon and Leyavin. I hope I pronounce well. In this steez you can find empty houses for quests. You can farm furnishing plants from there, and this place does not give you a bounty, and have too much cupboard and cabinets, which is nice. If you don't have Blackwood, it's okay. You can farm in Murkmire. In Murkmire, you can farm in Bright Throat Village, and you can find that house village upside of this Dominus Fatum. If you guys don't have Blackwood DLC and don't want to farm in Murkmire, which is ugly map, you can farm furnishing plants in Clockwork City as well. You can start at Bankside and you can move on to the Clockwork Castle. You can farm furnishing buttons from there. I think you say that from inside yourself, Clockwork's the ugly as well. I felt that you can farm in elsewhere, but northern elsewhere.
There is the temple right there, Two Moons Temple, right there. Right there is urns and coppers everywhere. You can farm from there, and you can farm at Rimmen City Castle, which is nice. You can farm from there as well. If you want to farm in Somerset, you can break houses and find good furnishing plants from there. You can farm in Vardenfell as well, especially Vardenfell tombs. Best tomb is Drelot ancestral tomb, but if you are not finished main quest yet, you can farm there. If you can get quest, you can reach the inside room, which is best urn farm location. You can farm in Somerset, but in Somerset I recommend it to you farming Shimmeren Temple. You can farm too many stuff in here. You can farm in Drenni Acropolis as well, but you have to take quest first. You can farm in Skyrim Solitude as well, especially in Skyrim Palace. You can farm furnishing plants from there. I think I said every place, every best place you can farm furnishing plant. If you want, you can do farming in place where there is no DLC. I mean base game maps. You can farm in base game maps as well, but I can say that it's not gonna worth your time when you try to farming furnishing plants in non-DLC maps. It's not gonna worth your time. Another topic, making money from events, game events. Listen carefully to what I'm about to tell you, because it will be very useful to you in next 5 minutes. Now I will explain all the game events, open world events, and how you can make money from them, one by one. Okay. First event I am talking about Jubilee cake events. These events usually start each April, each year in April. You are gonna get in this event, you are gonna get rewards like usual, style page, furniture receipts, etc. I mean, when you find any Jeppelin Paladin style page from that game event, or Imperial Champion style page, don't sell that items. After event finished, like 2 months later, 3 months later, you can sell from that style page. If this style page is around like 10k, when 2 months later you can see this price like minimum 15k, 16k. That's why that's the key point. That's why we are selling the 2 or 3 months later in these style pages. I'm going to talk about. Now I'm gonna sleep, man. Whatever. Now I'm gonna talk about Tribunal Celebration event. This event usually start at February to March. As the name of events suggest you these tribunals known have three lords. Tribunals, like member of the tribunal is Vivek, Almalexia, Sotasil. Each one of these characters symbolizes as a map. As you know, each of these tribunals characters has its own map. You can find, for example, you can find Almalexia in Mournhold, in a tribunal temple. Find Vivek in Vivek City, in Vardenfell. And you can find Sotasil in Clockwork City. So that means this tribunal event is changing map by map. For example, when this event start in Wardenfell and can finish in Clockwork City map. You are going to find Doctrine Ordinator style. The select town diver skin Runebox, Ramarius bait kit, Memento Runebox, Verminus fabricant pet fragments. You are going to find these items in this game event. So since this event in progress in three different map, each one of may have different start date. Each one of map have a different start date. But I can tell you this: get rid of the things you earned from this event in April, or even May, if it's possible.
Explorer celebration event. Although we don't see this event in the game like before, it usually comes to the game in May and November. In this event you will get double material when you farming. This event is on finish the maps you haven't completed yet. Do daily quests and farm materials. What you need to know before this event comes, the items in the game, especially price of crafting materials, will decrease. Will decrease the prices. Crafting material prices will decrease and then become normal. For example, if you have a tons of crafting materials, you should sell this crafting materials before that Explorers celebration event comes to the game. Before that sell, if you don't sell, you are about to losing money because the loot in the game is doubled when this event on. Another event, Imperial City celebration event. This event usually happens in September. Imperial City dropped are doubled. During this event, collecting Talwar stones every day makes you good amount of money. For example, with your Talwar stones you can buy powerful assault item coffers, and when you find eye stuff of powerful assault from there, It's like a minimum 1 or 2 million gold, around like this. When you find trophies, you can buy expensive items as well. You can find trove scamp and cunning scamp in servers. And when you go there with empty bag, you can farm all boss loots. You can get Molag Ball loots, especially when this event on, you can get soul Shivin skin more easier. During the event, you will be get Legion Zero strong boxes, Legion Zero style pages, Tools of Domination style pages, like this event items. Here's what you need to pay attention. When you find skin, style, or trophies, or you find powerful assault ice stuff from coffer, you need to pay attention. Don't sell these loots during the event. Sell all that items after 1 or 2 months later, after event done. Another event, Jester's Festival event. Jester Festival. Jester event usually start in March and finish last day of April. You are gonna get loot like Cadwell's Kitchen Arms style pages, Regal Regalia. I don't know how to pronounce that thing, but Regal Regalia outfit style pages. You can get Memento, playful prankster Memento in this event. The things I said before also apply to this event also. Sell all these items 1 or 2 months later after the event done. But there are some other items in this event, and we will take another action on these items. For example, when the first day of event, buy all whenever you find all festive nose maker mementos and jester festival joke popper memento fragments from all markets. Buy all these memento fragments, and all these fragments even first day, you are gonna give minimum 1 or 2k gold each one of these fragments. So after you buy, how much did you find fragments? When the last day of event, you are going to sell around like 30 or 50k minimum each one of these fragments, priced like this. In this way, you earn very good profit. Start collecting from the first day of event. You will see that price of these two fragments, which are 1 or 2k each one of price, has skyrocketed to 30 or 40k gold in last days of event. Because people are gain achievements with them, they're not try to finish their achievement when they start the entrance of the festival. Then they are try to finish that achievements in last days. That's why price like this. Lost Treasure of Skyrim event. This event, I really don't know this event came to game again in game, but if it came to game, Events start in September and event finish in October. During this event, you can make Western Skyrim, and you can do Western Skyrim and Greymoor daily quests, and you can find Sovngarde style pages or Niv style page. They attach to the game because they are not gonna give you one or two event style page. They have to attach to some style page too if this event happen. All you have to do is, like I said before, sell your earnings from the event ending after the ending event in like October. You should sell in December.
Oh, another event. Mid-year Mayhem event. This event happens. This event have two time in a 1 year. This event happens two time in a 1 year. For example, one for winter and one for the summer arrival. It's mean one event start in June and finish in July, and another part of the mid-year mayhem event start January and finish the February. While getting you are gonna to get the double AP, which is PvP currency, AP, double AP on PvP maps. And you can get extra loot by doing daily quests, daily event quests, and on event maps. You will find these items when during the event, Ebon Steel, Armor Outfit Style, the Legion Outfit Style, Legion Zero Outfit Style, like this. You have to dispose of what you earn in this event before the event repeats itself. I mean, you have to sell of what you earn in this event in first part of event. You have to sell before the event repeats itself. For example, if the first event start on June or July, you should sell that event items like September. If you can't sell that items of within this period, the event start again at January or February, you lose some gold or you will not earn a profit. Next is Neve Life Festival. It's really good for it's a really good event for making money, because so when the December or January come, event will show up. The key point is before that festival, Neve Life Festival, buy all furnishing items you find. Like mundane runes, regulus, especially heartwood. For example, you see heartwood price around like 400, right? When before that Neve Life Festival, this heartwood price around like 400 gold each one of, right? So when the festival came, I really don't know at the beginning of the event, but price goes higher like middle of the date or last days in the event. This hearthstone price like skyrocket, like
3 or 4k each one of Heartwood minimum. It mean at least 600%, I guess, profit you will get. And this event, you will get unique provisioning receipts, skin changer motif, towel, Nordic towel, and crystal frost skin charity breed, deep winter charity breed, imperial charity breed. I don't know how to pronounce, but I hope say it correctly. Rikinda left the Dwarven weapon style pages. You will in this event you will get these items, but don't sell before the summer when you find these event items, especially frost skin charity beads. You can find this charity beads have cheap price during the event, and you can sell these event items in June or July. Another event, Orsinium celebration event. Orsinium event is the most made event in the game so far. This event start in August or November, and last about 10 days. During this time, this 10 days, you will get double loot from Orsinium daily quests, Maelstrom Arena, world bosses, and map materials, map itself. You can also sell what you get from this event after a few months. It's same as other events. Maelstrom style can be dropped in Maelstrom Arena, farm it during the event and sell it months later. It's gonna give you good amount of money. Although it seems like short time, 10 days, but these 10 days, when this event arrives, Orsinium set piece will decrease. Orsinium set piece will decrease. Prices will decrease. If your vendor has Orsinium sets like Paria or Briarheart, that's mean you should sell this Orsinium set pieces before this Orsinium celebration event.
Another event, Pan Elsewhere celebration event. This event happens in July or August. You will get motif styles page during the event from the northern and southern Elsewhere zones. These motifs like Jezan Nisir, Anukia, Pelletin, Sunspire, Shield of Sanchal, Dragon Guard, Nemo Priest motifs. What you need to do here is to sell your event loot, these motifs, in the following months. When you find these motifs, don't sell in that month. 1 or 2 months later, price are doubled and you will get money from there. But what you need to pay attention to during this event, trade materials losing their value. I really don't know why. I'm not still figure out yet. I don't know why, but trade materials losing their prices in this event. So if you have trade material in craft bank, in your craft bank, sell it before this event. If you know why trade materials losing their value during the event, I will be glad if you write write in it, the comments. I wanna learn too. Somerset celebration event. This event, July to August, you will get Snowhawk, Snowhawk Mage outfit style from Golden Coffers, and you will get other items. Same thing that event too. Sell your event items after 1 or 2 months later. Thieves Guild and Dark Brotherhood celebration. This event usually in March, start in March, and like 10 days. You can get double loot from world bosses, dead bosses, crafting notes from Thieves Guild and Dark Brotherhood maps, trials, dungeons. Same thing that too. Sell your event items after 1 or 2 months later. Undaunted celebration event in December happens, like 10 days. During the Undaunted event, you will earn opal style pages like masks and shoulders in dungeons. You can collect these opal items very cheaply during the event, and you can sell in June or July. Last event I'm gonna talk about, Witches Festival event, October to November. In this event you will get Throwing Bones, Memento, Hollow Jack style page, Dremora style page, Witches Festival themed recipes, and Witches Festival wreaths, Glamoril treasure maps, Glamoril armor outfit style page, Grave Dancer weapon style page also. Same situation here too. Sell these items like 1 or 2 months later. In fact, the logic in the most of them is the same. We are selling the items few months later. I think I finished all the money making things to get you can get benefit from there. But I want to talk making money from sets, item piece sets, and chest farm. Now I'm gonna talk about the making money from set pieces, and chest farming. Where you should farm in chests if you want farm. But I'm gonna show you some tricks from there as well. So much people know about these tricks, but I'm gonna show it anyway. If the set, any set you are thinking of, is not in this video, you can be sure that set is not worth to farm and sell, because I will show you every good price, every good price sets. The price can go up or go down for conditions of today, the patch notes, and can change because of the patch notes. After every release, the market price really changed. I'm gonna show you the sets like not have price on add-ons as well, but worth to sell. First set, powerful assault set. Powerful assault. This set piece, people using the at tanking, usually tanks, especially off tanks. This is the best in slot set, powerful assault set. You can get the powerful assault kafa with your Telvar stones. When you open that kafa, even all set piece of this powerful assault set good to be sell. But when you find that ice stuff of powerful assault in that kafa, it's like around like 1.5 million, 2 million, around like this. And you can find Spinner Inferno stuff around like 500,000. Also, you can find Mother Sar of Inferno stuff around like 250k, 200k, like this. You can find any stuff of Hrothgar or Dark Convergence. Price have minimum 250k. If you find lightning stuff or the lightning stuff or of the dark that item set, that dark convergence sets, or ice stuff of the Hrothgar, you can sell at around like 500k minimum. Elfbane Inferno stuff, it's good as well. Also, Elfbane Inferno stuff also around like 500k gold. You can find Archer Mind, Spinner, Harbinger, one-handed weapons like axe, dagger, swords, around like 600k. Heartland, Deadly, Ravager, Ravaging, Briarheart, Vicious Death, Dead One-Handed Weapons around like 200 or 300k gold. Spinner, Briarheart, Spriggan, Vicious Death, Alessian set, Diamond Victory, Seventh Legion, Paria, Venomous, Footman, Desert Rose, like the two-handed weapons. All of these two-handed weapons have around like 100k. You can find bows, Swamp Raider bows, Venomous bows, Hawkeye's bows, or powerful assault bows, which is of tanks use as well. Cyrodiil crest, of tank best in slot set again. Cyrodiil crest, Briarheart bow, Shriven, Deadly, Warrior Poet bows around like 200k. I don't know why, but it is. You can find like powerful assault, Pluggy Breaker, Alessian, Potentes, Harbinger, Juggernaut, Paria. These shields around like 100 or 200k. You can find Dark Convergence, Mother Sorrow, some pieces of War Maiden, some pieces of Sivare skills, especially light armor parts. This light armor parts around 100k, 200k, like this. You can find Briarheart, Witch King, Marksman, some pieces of Morak tank, body parts, that body parts medium armor body parts, around like 50k, not much gold, but it's still worth to farm. Heavy armor piece, some pieces of Bahara's curse, really expensive, some pieces are not. Sivare scales, Paria, Hrothgar, some pieces of Vasalla, Guil, Battalion Defender. This heavy armor piece price like minimum 50k, maximum like 200k, some of pieces. Javelin price, I will recommend to you to farm like for, let's talk for necklace, like Plague Breaker, Paria, Mother's Sorrow, Hrothgar, Dark Convergence, around like 100k. For rings, ring price like the Spinner, Paria, Sivare Scales, Plague Breaker, Hrothgar, Briarheart rings, the also around like 100k. If you farm this, if you are gonna farm this, that items I have counted so far, you will earn good money. But you can get some of these items with Telvar stones, like Desert Rose, Powerful Assault. Some of them PvP set pieces, like Juggernaut or Deadly, you can get with your AP. But the rest of items are dead. You can collect with chest farming in Overland. So how you can chest farm in Overland? Buy some lockpicks on your bag and take treasure hunter CP. You can take a movement speed CP as well if you want. You should take movement speed buffs from your skills, or you can use wild hunt ring, or both of you can use both. And you should take legendary main passive abilities on you. If you don't know the location of the chest, definitely use the harvest maps. To be honest, I really want the I really don't like the harvest map add-on for chest farming, because I know the where is the chest. I really know where is the chest. If you don't know, you definitely use the harvest map. There is a point we should pay attention to here. While some set pieces are not worth money, and some set pieces are really good money in the same set pieces, which is not good to farm. We have to farm that sets, almost all parts of the sets worth to sell. For example, in these days, you can still sell Necropotence Javeleries, right? For a good price. Maybe you can find Inferno stuff, you can sell from good price as well. But when you find two-handed weapon or bow or bad trade body pieces part in this set, Necropotence, that pieces not that pieces part not give you good money. It's not gonna worth your time. What you need to do is farming. Every set pieces gives you good money, like Brightheart or Spinner or Spriggan. Every set piece really good money. it's worth your time like this. And another point to consider is you shouldn't choose a map with one good set for farming. For example, if you are farming in the Rift map, you are able to find three Overland sets, right? And these three sets almost garbage for dispatch. I mean, these three sets almost garbage. When you farm in this map, you are wasting your time actually. But for example, if you are farming in Vrodgar, in this patch, these two of the three sets are really expensive, like Paria and Briarheart. Hope you understand what I'm saying. Be sure to farm which sets are popular, because they're always change with a new patch and the patch notes. So let's talk about strange situations with some set pieces. Like when you find armor of trainee set, that armor set is pretty interesting because armor of trainee set have all types of armor, like heavy body parts, light body parts, medium body parts, and have different trait chevaleries, like healthy or robust. And the body piece you find from armor of training as a training trait and lowest level, higher the price, goes higher. For example, when you find maximum CPs, maximum CP training trainee piece, body piece, worth less than low level trainee sets piece. I remember light armor, trainee pant, and heavy helmet. I think these two items, heavy helmet and light pants of armor of trainee, drop chains lower than other pieces, I guess. For example, when you find light pants with training trait at trainer set, when you see price around like 2 or 3k in TTC or other add-ons, but I'm not gonna selling that item around like 2 or 3k because hard to find, you know. I can sell around like 10k, and believe me, most people usually buying that item. Another Overland set, Drug Heritage. I really don't know who is using that set. Maybe dueling guy, some guy fighting each other in Buruma. I don't know. This interesting set, Drug Heritage set, have lower drop rates, especially hat and weapons. You can sell that around like the head around like 5k and weapons around like 10 to 30k, but other pieces almost garbage. Another set piece, interesting set piece, Bahara's Curse. That item set pretty interesting too, because you can find helmets around like the 30 to 100k. I guess drop rates very low, that's why. But the tall other set pieces of Bahara Curse, because I talked about that before. in this video. Another interesting set is Bloodthorn Touch set. This set's pretty cheap in these days. Pay attention what I said, these days, because when the meta goes again to Magicka and Stamina regen, the price of this set is flying, you know. But when health recovery and maximum weapon damage goes meta, like today, price is crashing from this set, Bloodthorn Touch set. When you look at the patch notes and you think, or another patch, mostly goes important, Magicka and Stamina regen goes important, you can farm or buy cheaply from these days Bloodthorn Touch set. And when the patch notes come, when the new patch come, you can sell it from good prices. I think I talk about all good set pieces for selling. Okay, let's talk about Golden Vendor. Golden Jewelries. Almost all Golden Jewelries is worth to sell in this game. The important thing is gives you decent stats, like if any jewelries gives you decent stats like penetration, spell weapon damage, or regen, magicka recovery, or stamina recovery, etc. You have to buy this decent stats have jewelries. You have to buy this jewelries. Another point you should pay attention to is that jewelries you're about to buy from vendor with your AP, is that set piece meta or not. If it's meta, you will get extra money. As I just said, if it gives you decent stats like penetration, spell damage, etc., it will be meta one day, even if it's not meta. Oh, for crafting set pieces, if you are the crafter and like to craft the things and selling to the people, if you like that, there are sets that require less trades to craft but also brings you money, like Torix Pact, Seducer. This set piece have you need to have 3 trades. You can craft after you have 3 trades. Torix Pact for tanks and Seducer set pieces for healers and magicka deities. From 4 traits, you can craft Fortified Breath and Magnus Gifts set pieces. But these set pieces, you should take order from buyer. While crafting these tests, because to be honest with you, you can sell much in vendor with these sets. You should take order from buyer. Stonefire, I don't know how to pronounce that shit. Stonefire, 5 trade sets. People using in this in PvP these days, it's good to sell. Mechanical acuity from 6 traits. You can sell medium and light divine body pieces maybe javelins and weapons as well, but people using this mechanical acuity sets, their trash setup for mobs. Shacklebreaker from 6th rate set. You should craft order as well. This set too. Shacklebreaker. But if you are not going. You can't sell much Shacklebreaker sets in vendor, I guess. You should craft that Shacklebreaker sets. Craft to order as well. If buyer messages you, hey, I need the Shacklebreaker, yada yada yada, and you can craft there, but. It's not going to worth your time, to be honest, when you try to craft Shacklebreaker and try to selling at guild vendor. Maybe half of them can be sold, maybe not. It's like a coin trick, but you know. Oh, Love of Julianus, Love of Julianus. Julianus said from 6th rate as well, you can sell every piece and trade Julianus stuff, which is nice. Hunting's Rage from 6th rate set, which is everybody knows Hunting's Rage. You can sell every pieces too. From 7th rate, you can craft and sell clever alchemist weapons and javelins. Which is very expensive usually. twice born star. 9th rate set. At least one or two patch before, divine trade rates increase. So it's good to sell. It's good to sell for selling as well. Pelinal aptitude. Pelinal aptitude sets. It's 9th rate set as well. Hybrid builds start to become more functional. This patch, I think will be better in next patch. So it's good to sell set as well. New Moon Acolyte set, 9th rate. Usually these sets, weapon and javelin pieces have good prices as well. So if you want to crafting and you don't need to craft certain sets, for example, if you learn Nirnhorn weapons and armors, or javelins, javelry traits, especially new traits, you can sell what you produce with low cost and sell in the market with good prices. I think I talk about. I think I did. Talk about all of gold stuff, everything I know in this game about gold money making. I'm not saying that I show you guys 100% all of money guides, but 99% I guess I show. I know it's my videos like little bit boring. I'm get bored as well, but I don't want to talk like other YouTubers say, talking in 5 minutes like only one information in the five or 10 minutes. I just want to give all my information to you guys. So I'm not going to say subscribe, like, etc. If you want, go ahead. I don't mind. Well, this is the my last money making guide. I'm not gonna shut video about again about money. Maybe any guide. I'm not take video as well. But in another videos, I am talk about some of PvP builds, and I'm gonna show you guys some of broken PvP builds. If I'm not delete the game at my computer, and I guess I can talk about how you can make your PvP builds, maybe PvE builds as well. I can talk about this, but if I make this video, it's long like this. So thanks for watching. Have a nice day. Bye bye. Cheers.